меняет за собой первую позицию автомобиль Ferrari, Porsche второй. Юлук, автомобиль Aston Martin, и поддевает Porsche Ferrari вот так вот. Сразу буквально были какие-то повреждения. Смотрим, как это происходило. Porsche пошла в атаку по внешнему радиусу и начинала терять контакт с покрытием, поскольку был вылет небольшой, что привело к тому, что автомобиль Porsche задел автомобиль Ferrari вот так в заднюю ось, автомобили заднеприводные. И автомобиль Ferrari оказывается в гравии. Ой, мы видим вылет. Это была, по-моему, Ferrari. Поехал прямо. Ну, благо, большие гравийные ловушки на треке в Имоле. И мы видим, снова вылетает автомобиль по 25 номерам. Еще раз повтор. Вылета. Ну, мне трудно. А почему автомобиль Ferrari вот так вот оказался в гравии? Это похоже на просто... Машина задняя левая часть. Что произошло? Занесло. Ну как занесло? Просто оборвало в гравий часть заднего бампера. Нарушила аэродинамику, соответственно. Ханки, Aston Martin команды TF Sport. И пересекает первым финишную черту. Становятся Иоанн Ханки и Юлук победителями гонки в Имоле. Поздравляем великобританца, великобританскую команду. На второй позиции 458 Италия. На третьей.
Thank you. Engineering. Brundle is second fastest. Then third quickest is the number nine car of Eric Trouillet, has dropped onto dropped onto the turf. That means no traction whatsoever, and he tries to get it back. Almost does a really good job actually of rescuing that moment. But as we all predicted, really, 41 cars piling their way down the main straight and into Tamburello Corner for the first time. Somehow they all just about got through. An early overtake from Gary Finlay, but just tagging the rear of them.
Could that be any closer?
I don't think so. You normally can fit cigarette papers between these cars. In this case, you can't, because Simon Dolan almost being pushed down the straight, and Bjorn Wernheim gets fully alongside the G-Drive car. Simon Dolan trying not to, though, as far as the LMP3 part of the race was concerned, mainly between the 3 and the 2, United Autosports cars, and that's an uncharacteristic mistake from Matt Bell. This was the Villorba Henrik Hedman, but Hedman, shortly after that stop, was overtaken by Paul-Luc Chatin in the number 23 car. He's becoming heavy in the pit lane, Charlie George says in my ears. So spare a thought for anyone that needs to be out in the rain at the moment. Oh, a spin there for the race performance car. I don't remember that, incident at all. Through the kink at turn one. That happened to the 20s. And the camera.
Oh, big damage to the back of that car.
Oh, it's the run out of Acqua Minerale. And that's an unusual place to go off, actually. Over the break.
Look away, and I think we're going to. There's Barry Baxter.
The Orica 05 is running side by side into Tamburello Corner there. A little bit wide from Leo Rissell. This is a side swipe from the Edex Sport car on Pierre Nicolet.
In terms of traffic, we see here again what's happened, and that was a clash, I'm afraid, with the 48 car.
Car 48 from the gravel trap. Sideways moment for the in Italy. There was a frightening. We were actually on board with Ben Hanley when that happened.
Oh dear, and yeah.
That will have quickened the senses briefly as the car to Ben Hanley in the Dragon Speed Orica 05 and just about getting through at Variante Alta. Same couldn't be said, of course, later on for Ben Hanley.
No room quite there, I'm afraid, Ben.
We have got yellow flags for a car off, I think towards the end of the lap, so wait and see whether that needs further attention in terms of recovering it. It's been given a fair while now to extricate itself from the gravel.
And the Gibson stumbles over the RLR car. Over on the grass goes Ben Hanley and up the inside.
Another great thing for Ben Hanley is that Andreas Wirth was then balked by the car behind.
Yeah, certainly Andreas Wirth knew that at some point that...
Yellow corner. And was there some contact?
Nope. No.
Out on the marbles, really, for the number 8 car, having to stay off the racing line to allow the LMP2 car through. And there's just no grip, by the way.
Oh, double kiss,
he got a shove as well.
Billiards move there.
Bertolini, I think, could see it all happening and tried to go as far right as possible. A collision there between three different cars and more contact in the Ferrari. There's the number 10. Side of the bend, he's braked by the looks of things for Acqua Minerale at the normal point and then powered his way out and lost the rear end. Matthias Besch all of a sudden facing our camera, windscreen wipers working out. Let's have another look at exactly what happened. An awful lot of water pouring off the front wheels of that car and
intermediate.
That is the run down towards.
There's another car already off in the distance. Intermediate.
Who win the second round of the season, despite the last 45 to 50 minutes being held under Fabio Porcello and then a safety car because of a massive downpour in this part of Italy. Let's take nothing away from
several off-track moments for the 16. On laps under the wheels, and 1, 2, 3, 46, 38 and 21.
Position, Lance Stroll struggles off the line, and Ben Barleycoat gets rocketing into the lead of the race here. Could it? That's a perfect start for him, and Lance Stroll really struggling off the line. I'm afraid Max Gunther's had a good start and got himself into second place from that outside row. They go through Lagarde. Our first race here this weekend, and Wolf run into the barrier, a wheel missing. That's Piquet, isn't it? I think that's just talking about him, has pinched the barrier there, and that's the left rear clean off. In ninth place, and my apologies, it's not Piquet for the second half of the race. Just rid of his engine penalties is the driver third with Guan Yu Zhou, Ralph Aron, the two drivers. Piquet went in the barriers, gets underway, slippy sliding start for Callum Ilott. Bit of contact further back as the pack struggle to find grip on the still damp line off the start of the run. But George Russell off to the perfect start in the race. He leading Sergio Sete Camara. Callum Ilott really did struggle off the line, so he slipped back. Alessio Lama and quicker. No, it was another car clattering into the barriers. That was a biggie. Just in Formula 4 Championship last year. Another replay of that. Oh, the heavy hit with the barriers there. Looking up the inside, but the inside line is damp, is wet, so there's no really a chance to get through there. Out. Oh dear, that I think is the VAR car, the Van Amersfoort car of this weekend in support to Formula 1. And just straight on, Pont Oscar there, a lock-up, and if you lock up around this circuit, he has turned his fortunes around, and George Russell is a winner this season as he crosses the line and wins by a huge margin. Podium of the year, second place. Callum Ilott on the back that one, but it's been a good weekend for him so far. We're on back to form as well. He'll be playing. Cuts across, Lance Stroll gets into the lead of the race. And there's a crash already further back. We've got cars pointed in the wrong direction. Two have come together. Then there might be a pileup. One of the Framer cars is in there. There is a pileup. Nobody can avoid them. Well, the Mucha Motorsport cars get stuck in all of that as well. Maxi Gunther weaves around five, six cars that are stricken here. Nothing to do with that crash, but couldn't find a way around it. Couple of drivers slow off the line. Great start for Lorandi at the front of the field. And Sergio Sete Camara was one of them who got a bit of a tag by the looks of things. He's the one who's running the wrong way down the circuit. Then everybody else getting caught up and involved in that pileup just with nowhere to go. Cars all the way across the course. Then you can see Sete Camara and sent around and pointed in the wrong direction. Everybody else then hurtling towards him. He's just sat there waiting for the worst to happen. But thankfully, it doesn't look like it was too serious. The Mucha Motorsport car there, which I think is David Beckman, with its front left wheel hanging off its rear wing. Last year was gorgeous for most of the weekend. Thierry Lorandi. And there was the pass of the race. Joel Eriksson around the outsiders. And now we get a replay of Ben Barneycutt's move there up the inside of Harrison Newey. So that wasn't right at the end of the race. It was two or three laps from the end of the race. That's what happened to Harrison then. That's what. Severs in the Ecaris M4. And now, is that smoke from the car ahead? A lockup? No, that is damage. She's clattered the barriers there, and the Ecaris BMW is off. Let's get a replay and you can see exactly what happened there. Yeah, just understeered, and that was a big hit, wasn't it, into the barrier. You see what I mean about the smoke coming from the car ahead, though? And I wonder if some oil has come from that car, that Ginetta, and that was what caused him to slink. Let's have a look. Now, yeah, under braking, just snapped away from him. It's a big, strong car, that, though. The barrier probably came off worse. So we didn't see that, but that was a move which happened just ahead. Oh, and then clattering into the one point, the top three were very much together when Chris Vlock joined the party. Wasn't without incident. It's a fairly low speed incident before the pit stops. It's now down to ninth position and 10th from the very back of the grid. Luca Anselmi, the championship leader, and number 44 down the escape road. Drivers just a time for a quick word before they swapped over. Bat markers certainly were half of the race, particularly, I think, for number 84. A wait, there it is, and it's a win for Peter Terting, who takes the car home. And the work done in the first half of the race, of course, by his teammate Jörg Wibahn, who did a very good job off the line to get the car past. But the Ginetta has to settle for seventh in the end, and then still take eighth position in car 24. Anselmi get out the top 10. And there you see, that car was on pole yesterday. D4 RYS team car, and yes it was. No, sorry, it was number 14 in that sense. But then it becomes single file again up until you get to the top of Avenue de Pyrénées and the second turn. It's a replay of the start, and perfect start. Becky Jackson will be looking forward to getting in the car. And here's another Chevrolet Camaro about to launch another move up the inside into Pont Blanc, under the bridge to get to the order here. It's just ahead of the number 24 KTM Crossbow, the Hollinger car, eighth position. Here is a replay of this pretty forceful move. Now that was on the other Porsche. Forming up behind him though. Look at the BMW, makes contact there. The Allied Racing BMW and into the barrier. I'm afraid goes number 84. Is 5 seconds clear. Here's a replay. Door was open. BMW had a go. Then the door closed as he turned in. Contact between the left. All he can do is put the pressure on. But now I say that. He tries up the inside, gets all over the curbs, the back end of the course. 74 Cedric Frieberghaus. And there was the move. The BMW ran out wide through Virage de Garde. Contact here, spun around, 30 and 77 come together. 77, the Maserati of Fogliani, which already had a bit of bodywork hanging off it. It was a bit leery through the kink. Then it was a bit of a daredevil move, lock up. I think he actually tried to back out of the move because he realised it wasn't quite going to happen. But he was all locked up, he skidded straight on. And couldn't avoid running into the side of the Maserati, one of the quickest drivers out there. Now here's a replay of a move from the number 28 Allied BMW under pressure again from the Porsche. He's trying absolutely everything here to get through. Patzelt, can he find a way through at the best overtaking opportunity into turn one? Clock ticks down to 0 seconds now, but they've already crossed through the line, so they will get another lap at the end of this one as well. Good news for the Porsche going around the outside into Lagarde. Onto the power for Gramatico. The back end slips around. He doesn't get the grip he wants. The Porsche's got better grunt. He's got better acceleration. Contact! The top two crash. A full 360. The BMW carries on. The Porsche does a 720-degree spin all the way around. The BMW is now in trouble. Broken front suspension. The Porsche gets going and gets the lead of the race. Oh, goodness me. Could you have more drama at the end of the race? Gramatico is trying to make that car move. Stances, it is going to be another win for the Pro Sport Performance car, this time for Andreas Patzelt and Nicola Mollemadsen. They take the checkered flag. You look at the gap to second place and you think, oh, that was an easy race. It was not. What a battle that was with the BMW. The results on screen, an excellent result in sixth place, Phil and Gordon. Eighth place to number 13, number 14 KTM, Laura Kreiheimer and Jamie.
Turn one, building up to 160 miles an hour, locks the front brakes, and then just can't scrub the speed off, and bang, straight into the wall, and that is how we will end our session. And I can almost hear the sigh from the Campos mechanics from here. With Alex Palau, and look, we've got Giuliano Alesi just pulling out in Aitken, trying to hang on through turn four. Of course, he was second, and he's absolutely furious. The young Renault development driver with the new car in 2016. We're underway in Barcelona with a great start for the pole sitter, Hughes, and a terrific one. We've got a stall at the back, that's Jack Aitken. They've all managed to get round him, thank goodness for that. But meanwhile, we've got a car on the grass past Hughes on the inside, and that's going to be very close to contact with Fukuzumi in the background there. Oh my word, that was very close indeed. Up into the lead and down the inside. From the, is going the trident of Fuoco, going past the man who started on the front row, Kevin York, heading backwards. He started second, he's now down to fifth, and it's all so very tight at the moment. Got to be careful not to lose a wing or even a wheel in the opening lap by Konstantin Tereshchenko. So there's Dennis, and then watch at the top of your picture now as Tereshchenko clean a long way off the road with a huge snap of open. Charles Leclerc takes the checkered flag and wins in Spain. He dominates the first race of the year. So we've got a terrific run on the first out of the last corner, and Parry moving around left and right. Alexander Albon crosses the line to win the sprint race in Barcelona.
Поворот Эльф, затем следует поворот Рено, Репсоль, Сиат, с которыми участники столкнутся на протяжении всего сезона. А вот у нас и первая авария, в которую угодил гонщик под номером 9. Это Крис Бауэр, представляющий команду Forge Racing Team. Без изменений. Давайте посмотрим, что здесь произошло. Кристиан Энгельхарт и его поддевает. Достаточно серьезная борьба идет. Сразу три участника. Здесь и Джеффри Шмидт, и Кристиан Энгельхарт, и 10-й номер Бен Баркер. Сразу втроем они попытались войти в очередной вираж, что привело, конечно же, к столкновению. Больше всех в этой ситуации выиграл Бен Баркер, который сразу... ...о том, что любой автомобиль, располагающийся в опасном вираже, в опасном повороте, должен быть эвакуирован в линии обязательно. Но у нас небольшая пауза после 10 лет назад и время Кайроли минута 50-187. Ну а Матье Жемине отстал от Кайроли более чем на полсекунды. И Виктор Хименес показывает нам его. Про этого испанского гонщика я уже говорил. Он является уроженцем Мадрида. Бен сейчас является таким. Ходит именно в борьбе за попадание в восьмерку сильнейших. Ибо нам не показывают лидеров, где по-прежнему все очень и очень стабильно. Да, первая пятерка по-прежнему без изменений. Тем временем Хименес и Линдленд получают штраф. Проезд по питлейну. Ну а здесь, ох, какая красивая борьба идет в середине. Борьба за десятую строчку. Показывает нам Пола Риса, который стал участником инцидента во время квалификации с автомобилем француза Стивена Палетта. Но, в отличие от француза, сумел продолжить борьбу в квалификации Рис. В итоге показал 11-й результат. Ага, здесь здорово перетормаживает. Тири был самым стабильным гонщиком. Ну а нам показывают Маттео Кайроли, как он атакует по ребрике. И здесь буквально с фазе свободного полета находился Нью Холланд и устремляется на финиш. Итальянец видит первым клетчатый флаг.
Here's how it happened then. Turn four, such a problem. Not all the tracks have gravel traps. His teammate Lynn, but Lynn's fighting back. Nato trying to hold on to second. You've got Sorokin and Malia dueling on the left-hand side of your picture as Gasly goes defensive on Nato. And it's Latifi trying around the outside. Sorokin past Lynn already. He's trying to go around the outside into two. We've got Ollie Rowland off the road.
Fist I've ever seen.
On board with Sergei Sorokin. So you see the huge amount of wheel spin that Alex Lynn had in front of the Russian driver. Also having a look at the superb start of Latifi alongside. And then it got very close indeed, as you see the long run to turn one. The Frenchman battling for the lead. And Latifi was very brave. Look how close that was. And he had to use the AstroTurf. Mitch Evans into turn number one. So you can see Ollie Roland rejoining in front of you there. And then
there goes
the
Giotto.
Rapax spinning around. So not the start to the season Giotto would have wanted. So he's tagged at the back there. And yeah, that's a puncture.
Giotto.
And then straight to the scene of the accident at turn two. Such a shame because he was the top rookie on the grid. As we get another look at it, he's already off at that point, and then nothing he can do. Simply a passenger. That's absolutely crucial, past the hard tyres of his teammate, Markelov, making his way past, and there was nearly contact between the inside to try and defend. It's Malia.
Kanamassas
trying to go. Kanamassas trying to go around
lovely.
The outside. He's keeping his foot in all the way around the outside. And what a move that happens. And he's drawing in the slipstream. You can see Latifi driving on his mirrors. Goes to the inside. Can Markelov go all the way around the outside of turn one? Ooh. He's being forced wide. So close to con.
Yes,
is he going to have a lunge? No. Not yet. And it's all off that final corner. It's all the traction off that final corner because you could see. Oh, he spun it! He spun round!
No.
He takes his hand off the steering wheel! Oh, and he was so close to getting collect. Per stop, considering it was their first one, as we go back to the incident that has us under safety car conditions. Sorokin, he's going to be accelerating out of turn two. He can see second place, and then around he goes. And that's what I was talking about. He knew almost as soon as he'd done it. The clutch tried to keep his race going, but just accelerating out of two, and that shows you the fine line. That shows you the balancing act.
The 34-5, Gasly 36-0.
This was the move that potentially could decide the race, and that really was so bold. Down the inside, Gasly.
Markelov going for the outside line. A little lock up from Kanamassas.
Is he going to be out? Is Markelov going to go round the outside? He's already tried it, and a huge chunk of time. Surely he's going to try down the inside. We know he's going to try down the inside, and we know Kanamassas is going to defend. He's got third place. It's a maiden podium at the moment. Gasly, who looked like he was going to win this race at one point, going down to third place. Latifi up to second, and Markelov has gone up to fourth place. Board with Alex Lynn, who's going to take the position away from Sergio Kanamassas with real ease. You can see the problems. Let's see what happened. Oh, it's not even a move. Not even a move from Antonio Giovinazzi, the rookie driver. And are we about to have the safety car as we see the accident?
And punting him out of reverse grid pole.
Oh, it doesn't get more painful than that. He was pretty upbeat yesterday, despite it. Absolutely sensational.
I'll tell you what.
There's the checkered flag for Norman Nato, who wins for the first time. He's challenging Marcello, who knows he's got to hold on to it. He's trying to go around the outside of him. He's going to put his nose in there. So close to contact, and he had to back out of it. That's going to make him very vulnerable indeed to Alex Lynn, who's trying to go around the outside, and we're on board with the British driver.
Great. Now they're with Sorokin from the back.
Sorokin, and have a look further up. So close to contact, but on the right of your picture, a slow-starting Norman Nato. So won the race yesterday, started in 8th position. He has dropped down to 19th. So our race winner yesterday really, really struggling as Sorokin tried to steam around the outside. That was the route he was going to take, and you see him get squeezed. Sorokin is up to 17th from his lowly starting position of 21st, and he can go race back on board. This is how Alex Lynn made the move. King trying to take the lead, trying to be bold on the opening lap. Top of the order, here's a move going on further back. We said Giotto was going to be on the move, and that's Sorokin, the two men who are out of position, going wheel to wheel. This is the use of DRS. Lynn going for the lead. He's down the inside. A lock-up from Marcello. Going to be so close. Who's going to yield? Alex Lynn's got Markelov going through, and here comes Latifi past Kanamassas. Back to Pierre Gasly, who's getting past Raffaele Marcello to get up. It's Mitch Evans racing his teammate. Campus on campus into turn one. Galau and Evans, and no favours being given by Galau, who shuts the door. Here is Sergei Sorokin making amends, carving his way through. Going to try and make a move on his teammate. His teammate's expecting it, driving and moving through upper position.
Nice.
Artem Markelov.
Going to put a move on. Oh, that's beautiful. On Giovinazzi up the inside at Sandberg Corner.
We see it once again down the inside, and Giovinazzi knew it was not a lot of wing. And here I talked about the two GP3 graduates racing wheel to wheel. And Luca Giotto, who was in the wall. Yes, and Giovinazzi thinking about it, and Sorokin's had enough. He's going to the inside. He's going to barge his way past Mitch Evans. He's forced him off the road.
Dropping back like stones, and it's going to be into Sandberg corner, isn't it? Yeah, rolling up the inside of Kanamassas. No way he's going to defend that. A lovely instinctive move. Bowled up the inside from Ollie Rowland.
And it's Malier, and here's a move from Giovinazzi. Oh! Contact! And a huge accident as Giovinazzi loses the wheel and into
big.
The
oh,
wall
big.
Heavily at turn number 10. That will be an immediate safety car. And that was robust defence. Here we go. This is down the back straight heading to turn 10. Use the DRS. Campos have been struggling. And there's the squeeze. And Giovinazzi simply not expecting it. That's how Peak was taken out. You see it in the foreground. And ooh, that is a really nasty bit of air before he hit the wall.
I think the stewards are going to have a word with him here, because he goes to defend, makes the one move, then makes a second move, and it's on that second move that he gives him no space. There's only probably half a car's width there, and Giovinazzi's got nowhere to go. He's already got the run on him. He's already got the pace on him, and at that point, he's going straight into his rear wheel. Nothing he can do about
and
it at Pete that point.
Would not have believed just to see. He wouldn't have known it. He wouldn't have been looking at his wing mirrors at that stage. And Arta Peak, the tarmac, and there's the air that the gravel trap can provide. And then hands off the steering wheel as he makes impact with the tyre barrier. Glad to say he is seemingly all right. He, of course, will be. Oh, look at that. Really displaying the speed differential between the two cars. Not what we like to see, but thankfully he is on first appearance out of the car, all right. He'll be assessed at the medical centre. Seeing it once more,
one,
so there's a width.
Twice.
And
two
then
moves.
There is not a width.
It's the fact that it's not one distinct defensive move.
You can't lose that late.
He makes the first, and then he makes the second, and it's that second move, as you say, that cuts that gap to less than a car width.
Under the safety car, Alex Lynn, for the second consecutive season, wins the sprint race in Barcelona from Pierre Gasly. Brave stuff. Morgan gets fired out wide all over the bypass there. The little runoff area on the outside, and he's under attack as well. At the inside of him came a hard charging Stian Paulsen. Frusto corner, three wide. And then they worked their way down to the end of Vale, where Morgan and Paulsen ran together. Over the curb went Stian Paulsen. There was a little bit of leaning. The stewards had a look at it, but no action was taken during the race. Morgan had his nose in front as they ran through club corner. He ran wide, so straight back at him comes Mikael Ashkona in the black and white car on the outside at the end of Vale. Can't do it. Laps around the Silverstone Grand Prix circuit. Briche had a go on the outside line to get past Morgan. That didn't work, but he did give Lucille Cipriano a chance to...
Which is part of the Volkswagen group, as we're looking at a slow-mo and a replay of the Auric incident, yeah, that's still under investigation. So
in this year, Niels Langeveldt comes over the timing line in the Vapura Motorsport car to win from Mikael Ashkona. The gap at the flag just under 3 seconds.
Langsamer Fahrt, also hier muss es noch irgendwo die Autos.
Race on day one found himself in more strife towards the end of the lap. Paul Rossell and Lorenzo Barra da Vega squabbled amongst themselves. Further up the road, there was drama which sorted out Julien Briche and others. And then in the background, there was Niels Langeveldt as he got involved with Mikael Ashkona, and Langeveldt was going no further. Lucas Oric was the next one to come up and try his luck, but as it turned out, he got in the inside of Paul Rossell, turned him around, so Oric was out with damage. Lorenzo Barra da Vega gained 2 places, and Rossell's race started to unravel from there as more damage meant the car was compromised. Lucille trying to work his way through towards the front of that little group. There were Seats everywhere, as then coming down towards Brooklands, there was more drama as Jimmy Antunes turned Lucille Cipriano sideways, and Antunes straight away was in strife. He headed for the pit lane, and lots of these incidents under investigation. The full story still to come. De Vega made a mistake coming down towards Brooklands. That got Facundo Della Motta up alongside him. They ran side by side in towards the right at Lafield. They turned their way through the loop. Cipriano and Della Motta a lap later came through side by side. Lucille Cipriano on the outside line got a squeeze. There was contact, but amazingly, the cars barely wavered an inch. They battled on. Motta then had to start defending to keep at bay Mikael Ashkona. And even at the end, Ashkona was busy battling with Della Motta. He went through at the end of Vale, forced out wide, as Morgan came up to attack for second place against Lorenzo Barra da Vega. He couldn't quite do it at the end. Paulsen is all ahead of this, about to come through and score a second win of the year, so the first double victor in this year's championship. There is Stian Paulsen to win. It's going to be Lorenzo Barra da Vega who hangs on to second place just ahead of Alex Morgan. Good for the podium.
They go out now, and away they go down towards Copse Corner for the first time. One car pretty slow away at the back, but it's the Pulsar to Max De Forni who leads the way into Copse for the first time. Are they all going to get round? One or two cars running a bit wide over the curves. It looks like they have all made it round. It's De Forni who leads the way ahead of Palmer.
Go. So does the cutback. So he makes him go deep into Brooklands. Does the cutback. It's a bit of a half-hearted move.
Wallop.
Yeah, that's a tough one to call, really, to be honest with you.
Taking the South African out of competition. While a moment for both Alex Gill and Julian Falcaro allowed James Allen to do sixth position. With a couple of laps remaining, Dorian Boccolacci finally...
Still battles going on further back down the field. They haven't given up yet, have they?
No, this is Bastone. He takes his second win of the season in the Formula Renault North European Cup. Second will go...
Can do down that long Wellington. Whoops. Oh, we got a spinner.
Now that's a bit ordinary.
Oh.
Well, safely round Copse, although inevitably one or two run way, way, way wide over the curb. Now up towards the dauntingly fast Beckett's S's for the first time. Sharp intake of breath at this point. Are they all going to wriggle through safely? Once again, Alex Gill tries to make his move up on the inside. This time it's going to pay out for him. And also, as they work their way to
slipstream, the car.
His way through. This is Village, tight right-hander. Named after Silverstone Village,
oh,
not John Village team
wide,
manager. And that is, I'm afraid, an accident waiting to happen. It's the AVF car. De Forni has to go defensive, so that means Boccolacci can escape. Deruvola to the outside line at the end of Vale. He's done it! That was
no.
A really good break.
And nor could Deruvola move up the order. He would stay fourth. Bartolomé Mieretzky was coming under attack, and Hugo de Sadelier eventually found a way past him. He gained ground on the inside.
2.0 NEC here at Silverstone. He crosses the line, moves up towards the pit wall to say thanks to all the engineers as he comes past them. Will Palmer will take second, Dorian Boccolacci third, and just for four
commitment. And Lando Norris with just patience that Sascha Fenerstrass was 13th ahead of Hugo de Sadelier.
To be on song for the whole race, whereas one of these guys...
Whoops.
You know,
sorry to interrupt
yeah.
you. Beckett's S's for the first time. Vito Posiglione came under attack and lost out. As round the outside of him. Dennis Lynn built up the advantage as Christopher Zerkling started to attack.
Harold Schmidt making mistakes, safety car comes out, all of that advantage you've gained gets lost and eaten away. So there's the spin, and that is a big, big spin, saved by the...
You've got to factor in the pace of Federico Fulgenzi, so if he turns out to be slower and loses places, plus you add 10 seconds, it's a different story altogether. Dennis Lind here trying
very
to work
close.
His way through the back markers, and this is always a bit of a scare for the race leader.
Sure, from that car, but obviously they've would have swapped driver. Here we go, so a nudge from behind, tapped from behind... Gets it going, bit of a...
Just up the road is Christoph Lenz, but Postiglione runs way wide, coming out of club corner. And if they're clamping down on track limits, some of them squabbling over fifth place. Some of the back markers running wider and wider, coming out of club corner.
As they come into Vale, stamping on the brakes. See the car swarming, and it's a very late lunch.
Jake Rattenbury ended up in the gravel, courtesy of a whack. From the Raton Racing car, a big spin over the grass. There's damage on Zerkling's car,
yeah.
And Schlegelmilch is delayed in all of that. But Zerkling's car, I don't think,
Whoa.
Wants to go in a straight line because it's got damaged suspension. And that is just about going to be able to get to the finish if he's very, very lucky. Because at the end of Vale, that's Zerkling who's got it all wrong under braking. He comes across the road. Schlegelmilch has nowhere to go. They make contact, but if they touched on those sides. To one another. After this as well, there is the flag. Dennis Lynn takes a second win of the year in the Lamborghini Blancpain Super Trofeo. We looked after 24 lap team, the AM-class winner. And pre-qualifying session, incidentally, has just failed with poor Nuri Sahin. The back of the grid ends up in strife. Schlegelmilch then slots in behind in second place. Postiglione gets up the inside and takes them. Ah, that's the answer, isn't it? Kodrich hit Schlegelmilch. That's where the damage is done to the green car. So that's how Schlegelmilch initially looks like he's got away with it, but the damage is such that he limps on rather than being able to fight back. So Harold Schlegelmilch has pitted. That is Fabrizio Del Monte's view. Down the straight, that's how it happened. Parts company, trying to see whose car it is. That very nearly flipped over, didn't it, as it bounced into the air there. Was that Christoph Lenz in 58? And the wheel thinks, I need to get out of the... Can Zerkling make this move stick then before he gets down to the end of Wellington Straight? No, he can't. The boards are there. The flags are waved. And that, up the inside, is William Barbosa. That's definitely under yellows, and he backs out this in the blue car. Lynn to the inside, and there's contact. Off the road he goes. Postiglione hits him as well, turns him round.
Up and locking the brakes up on the way in. So making a mistake there into Vale. Oh, Lint really is in the... Is that Lint? Is it his number 90?
Number 60.
Oh, what is he...
That's the red mist, isn't it?
He's
completely
the red
mist.
Very aggressive today. Yeah, yesterday.
And he recovered for 8th, but it could have been so much better. And he then had another drama with Crane. They're not going to finish. And that is how Pavlovich got to the end of the gravel bed.
He nearly kept it going. So as you are probably aware...
Climbing line here with the Raton Racing car heading into the braking area, being pursued by 73,
which spins. Through Cops. Go on, keep it going. Down the gears, down the gears. No. No, very talented.
That's Pavlovich rejoining from somewhere.
Where
he went off at the end of Vale.
That?
And I think he's gone... Fabrizio Del Monte. Amir Krenzia for the third time was the one that's just had a drama. Two were caused by Dennis Lind, and
teammates.
Lind gets himself up the inside there of the sister car. Back, oof, he's on the limit, isn't
nice
he? Dennis
slide.
Lind there, big, big slide. And there, Freddie Barth gets up the inside of Sergio Campana. So Barth in the Mad Croc car, brakes late.
But right. let's hold this pack up a little bit and let me get away.
And that Pellegrinelli in the dark blue car being held up, and past him goes Henri Assid, but not for long as Pellegrinelli gets up the inside now, coming into Aintree. The one they're trying to find a way past is Nicola DeMarco. Good flag at the ready, and Vito Postiglione it is who wins. From Enrico Fulgenzi and Henri Assid. Border, you start to see those that lock any rotations. Milos Pavlovic is...
A little earlier, one of the Lamborghinis, as you go back to the team, Parker Bentley's.
Oh, there he goes.
Just an unassisted and... Yeah, I mean, it went Taja cold, of course, still, so the car's going to... To me, that's... Oh, the Aston and the Ferrari somehow came together.
No, the Aston's in Brooklyn's. Different.
Is that the
different,
okay, different something came together with the Ferrari and a big heavy hit. With the right side of the car, look at the wheel. It's just, well, I imagine the suspension damage.
Yeah, there's the replay of Geddes. Up the inside. Does he get a tap? No, he just loses it.
No, he just loses it, just on the throttle too aggressively. And,
Courage.
Oh, yeah, well, again.
Spins
wide. And the Bentley. Sideswiped by the and very lucky not to get caught. That would have been a big, big impact.
The Bentley, Johnny Adam now comes up to challenge as well. And the Jaguar, no, the Mercedes rather, of Mauro Engel gets between them as well. Tour comes over the line, chasing hard. The gap at the end, 0.963 of a second. And Shane van Gisbergen and Rob Bell round out of Pierre Aret and Steph van Kamp coming from the Mercedes of Jean-Luc Bobolik, each number 111 at the early. And so with also 70.
Дмитрий Брагин и Алексей Дедукало. Кто из них первый войдет в поворот? И Дмитрий Брагин. На пол корпуса оказывается впереди. Снаружи идет Алексей Дедукало. Кто-то вылетает в песок.
И мы видим, что на четвертое место прорывается Роман Голиков.
Сквозь... В заднем бампере практически повисла Honda. Еще один автомобиль, который достаточно заслужен, практически ветеран в нашем отечественном кольце. Но вот сейчас демонстрирует очень неплохую. Яшин Чернев на 7-й позиции. Ранее только что видели повтор старта. И так вот фрагмент. Еще раз видим, те, кто смотрит нас на экранах, попытку вот этой отраги внутри пытался протиснуться. Званкин.
Андрей Юшин, к счастью, очень вовремя увернулся от сталкивающихся автомобилей.
Причем оба автомобиля продолжили борьбу в этом заезде с Максимом Черневым и Антоном Бадоевым, чья BMW идет на второй позиции.
И прямо сейчас Дмитрий Брагин первым пересекает финишную линию. Вот.
спортивные комиссары внимательно смотрят, не было ли фальстарта у кого-то из пилотов. Мы видим, как вплотную идут
и два автомобиля. Был контакт между Михаилом Митяевым и Денисом Булатовым. Пилоты стали эти гоночную траекторию. И тем временем на третью позицию, вот сейчас во втором повороте, как мне кажется, выходит автомобиль под номером 43.
Пары идут оба автомобиля, но внутри поворота оказывается пока Андрей Масленников. За ним Луцкий Черевань на седьмую позицию прорвался. Радошнов только восьмой. Вот так вот.
Достаточно плотно преследует Дмитрия Брагина. Тут же только что борьба между Григорием Бурлуцким. Это молодой московский пилот на входе вот эту мини-змейку на подходе к пятому повороту. Он опережает Эльдара Рахматуллина.
На втором
Андрея заныривал в повороте. Повороты гораздо охотнее, гораздо эффективнее. Прямо сейчас атака в исполнении Григория Бурлуцкого на автомобиль Андрея Масленникова. Но слишком высока была скорость на автоторможении. Сносит автомобиль питерского пилота в сторону. И тут же вот так жестко его атакует Эльдар Рахматуллин. Мало того, что проходит напрямую, так еще и подталкивает слегка.
Да еще и Андрей Радошнов прорывается, пользуясь тем, что Андрея Радошнова два Андрея сейчас сошлись в этом левом повороте, в левой шпильке пока. 276 тысяч, атака, смотрите, Денис Булатов внутри проходит Дмитрия Брагина.
Только ближе к середине заезда он попытался выйти в лидеры. И
вернуться, и сейчас атака Андрея Радошнова. Вот так, не оставляет он практически Андрею Масленникову.
Складывается ощущение, что поздно, судя по всему, поздно нажал на педаль тормоза. В прошлом году весьма уверенно боролись за места на подиуме. Где Андрей Николаев из Москвы? Прямо сейчас, кстати, атака Эльдара Рахматуллина. Очередная атака на позиции Kia Rio Андрея Масленникова. Тут же Владимир Черевань пытается воспользоваться этой борьбой, чтобы отыграть сразу две позиции.
Три машины. Сейчас в левый поворот у нас будет с вами. И Андрей Масленников находится чуть быстрее. А тут же Эльдар Рахматуллин по более выгодной траектории отправляет так Андрей Масленникова. Ну и часть для сликов, это, конечно, очень опасно. Внутри хотел оказаться Андрей Масленников, оказался, но только внутри у Владимира Череваня. Плывается немножко Эльдар Рахматуллин. Этим тут же пытается воспользоваться Владимир Черевань, но не получается у Владимира Череваня. А вот Андрей Масленников пытается вернуть себе одну из утрак. И наши поздравления еще раз Дмитрию Брагину, Денису Булатову. Он
проведенных в рамках первого этапа российской серии кольцевых гонок. А тем временем мы видим, что Михаил Митяев буквально потерял сразу несколько позиций. Сейчас его автомобиль даже не продолжает движение. В настоящий момент, вне всяких подозрений. А на вторую позицию тем временем пытается пробиться Владимир Шишенин.
И
это ему удается. А тем временем нам возглавляет заезд черной Рио команды спецавтопласт Моторспорт.
Какое там столкновение,
да,
смотри.
Где-то в середину первой десятки сейчас откатывается.
Это Андрей
Василий
Петухов и еще одно столкновение.
Как раз, по-моему, тот самый питерский картингист, о котором вы говорили в самом начале
представления.
Всеволод Гоген теряет
номер.
Контроль над своей машиной, но продолжает движение в данный момент.
У картингистов легко восстанавливается контроль. А уж с национальным классом они справятся. Тем более, что энерговооруженность у картов, у современных спортивных картов, конечно же, очень и очень высокая.
Виталий. На автомобилях «Лада» это Владимир Шишенин и Андрей Петухов. На четвертую позицию вырвалась Наталья Гольцова.
Всего одну позицию. И сейчас его 25-й стартовый номер. Volkswagen Polo Sedan. Характерной окраски B-тюнинга. Команды, которые из первая треть гоночной дистанции класса национальный. И на Наталью Гольцову атаку совершает Александр Голованов. К радиусу и борт-аборт идут две машины к повороту. Сейчас вот так слегка подталкивает слегка Александр Голованов Наталью Гольцову, и она уступает ему дорогу. Но опять внутри оказывается Наталья Гольцова. Но следующий поворот на слевый, а здесь у Голованова ситуация чуть получше.
Честно говоря, та его машина. И здесь что смотрим, что происходит. Ошибка в исполнении Анны Александровой. Как раз остается примерно половина заезда, и на наших экранах схватка между Александром Марушко, которого я так самоуверенно прогнал со старта гонки, и Ефимом Гантмайхером, которому не
вышел на старт, ему не везло. А вот сейчас пытается Ефим Гантмахер отыграться. Но пока Александр Мурашко довожает штрафную площадку.
И тут же мы видим, что отрывается колесо у машины одного из братьев Головановых. Это... Итак, Владислав Гоген прямо сейчас обозначает себя в зеркалах заднего вида. Не просто обозначает, а пытается обогнать автомобиль Александра Мурашко.
Очень красивый.
И сейчас именно Владислав Гоген занимает седьмую позицию в этом заезде. Но Александр Мурашко контратакует во втором повороте. Немного контактной борьбы. На стартовую прямую тольяттинский пилот и первым пересекает линию финиша. Набирают ход, и мы видим, что Рено Твинго Ильсура Ахметвалиева очень активно и быстро разгоняется на стартовой прямой. И тут же номер три, это Михаил Митяев, компенсируя свои вчерашние неудачи, пытается вырвать лидерство в этом заезде на входе в первый поворот. Нет, пока Рено Твинго впереди под номером два. Пилот ведет заезд, а тем временем уже на третьей позиции только Андрей Масликов. И тут же борьба за лидерство, и Михаил Митяев выходит вперед. Желтая калина под номером три возглавляет пелотон.
За Михаилом Митяевым это сейчас Андрей Масленников.
Да, к сожалению, была ошибка Успеева в тот момент, когда его атаковал Михаил Митяев. Очень широко заходил во второй поворот гонщик из Татарстана. И в ходе в первый поворот в конце гоночной, в конце стартовой прямой занимает внутреннюю траекторию Денис. Тем самым пробует обезопасить себя от атак со стороны.
Ступеньку пьедестала почета, на которую пока претендует Ахмед Валеев.
Атака в исполнении Игоря Самсонова. Он на третью позицию. Сейчас на входе во второй поворот Ильсур будет атаковать. Он внутри. Очень удачно расположен его Рено Твинго. Главное вот здесь вот не выехать слишком широко. Потерял гонщик из Санкт-Петербурга, который вроде бы сказал, что он вчера берег свой автомобиль, чтобы сегодня выигрывать.
Ильдар Рахматуллин.
И тут же один автомобиль Volkswagen Polo вылетает в повороте на хате. В конце стартовой прямой Денис Булатов, номер 22, атакует Игоря Самсонова в борьбе. Трудно сейчас сказать, в борьбе за какую именно позицию. Марк, место в заезде.
Да, так оно и есть. И сейчас нам показывают другое сражение.
И как будут развиваться события, прямо сейчас видим. На подходе ко второму повороту на внешней стороне Масликов пытается по внешнему радиусу объехать Михаила Митяева. Но с опытным тольяттинцем этот номер готовы мы были увидеть развитие событий на входе в третий поворот. Масликов первый! Я вижу, что Масликов первый выходит из третьего поворота. Гонщик из Подмосковья опережает пилота из Тольятти. Но борьба не закончена. Здесь очень сложная S-образная связка срезает, которая... Машина под номер 3 впереди, и сгорает мотор у автомобиля Масленникова. Или, скорее всего, да, скорее всего, речь идет о повреждении мотора, потому что, насколько я понимаю, коробка передач не может выдать столько дыма.
Да.
Масленников не вычеркнул бы. И вот сейчас прямо мы видим, да, на ту самую легендарную полосу, узкую полоску песка. Но достаточно и 250, чтобы выиграть заезд в классе Touring Light.
Тим Чернев ему это не позволяет.
Николай Карамышев очень агрессивен на входе.
Провалили старт и Дмитрий Брагин, и его одноклубник, хочу вам сказать. Стартовый номер 23 Павел Яшин.
На радость своему лабрадору по кличке Альп, который, как и всегда, на близких к Москве гонках присутствует в паддоке. А нафтаться-то в этих связках, в этих змейках. Там, конечно, можно хорошую скорость развить, но очень узкая трасса. И тут же, в борьбе за лидерство, Николай Карамышев на холме по внешнему радиусу пытается обогнать Павла Яшина.
Пока за третью позицию и столкновение. Фрагменты кузовные летят от автомобиля Дмитрия Брагина. И второй автомобиль этой команды Таиф
Калиментов отвалился от него Сиата. И тут же Ирак Минахметов атакует позиции Павла Яшина в борьбе за второе место. Очень удачная атака. Алексей Дудукало тут же пытается.
Может быть и на второй. Нет, пока,
а вот сейчас
пока
еще вопрос. Сразу двух человек пытается. Он отлично, как здорово. 11-кратный чемпион мира буквально проскочил.
Мир, России, погоди.
Непосредственных попыток огона сейчас не предпринимает. А вот Андрей Юшин предпринимает, но на не самой лучшей траектории. Сейчас он находится более уверенно расположен. Максим Симонов, тем не менее, пытается проскользнуть между двумя ладами Грома Симонова на длинной прямой, на стартовой прямой трассы Смоленское кольцо. И сейчас аккуратно Honda Civic пыталась вписаться в первый поворот, но все-таки...
Этим воспользовался Ефим Гантмахер.
Объективы с борьбы Юшина и Гантмахера, резко вырос разрыв между ними, автомобиль под номером 46. Параболика, выход на стартовую прямую, мелькают, мигают стробоскопы и пересекает финишную линию. Алексей Дудукало выигрывает первую гонку в этом сезоне на третьей позиции, и следом блестящий результат Ирака Минахметова. Шин Александр Малинин срываются со старта на стартовой прямой с первой линии, но Виталий Примак на той самой новейшей «Ладе Калине» опережает обоих и имеет очень хорошие шансы стать лидером на выходе из первого поворота. Похоже, именно
как
так и происходит.
Говорила. Как
разворачивает Владимир... Нет, это Александр Мурушко зигзагом едет в первом повороте, и вот это уже больше похоже на класс национальный. Сразу несколько бемперов у нас в первом повороте остаются. Снова не везет Александру Голованову. Второй сход. Ход, похоже, в двух заездах класса теряет позиции, немного теряет время. Алексей Шин тем уже порядка 7 позиций отыграл.
Да, и надо сказать, что первая тройка стремительно отрывается от второй четверки.
Сейчас очень жесткая борьба за третье место. Шишенин, Петухов, Гантмахер на входе в первый поворот сталкиваются. Не очень понятно, зачем смещался сейчас влево Андрей Петухов. Может, просто машину немного потерял на торможении. Здесь у нас Юлия Струкова в компании с Глебом Кузнецовым.
Свои Субару в классе Супер Продакшн.
Поиск по фамилии Огошков появлялся на старте заезда. И прямо сейчас он Алексея Шина на входе в первый поворот обгоняет. Тут же пытается протиснуться в Романа Огошкова. Вообще-то мы думали, что гораздо активнее будет Роман на своем супербыстром Kia Rio. Говорят, что мощность мотора на 17 лошадиных сил выше, чем у Калины.
Глеб Кузнецов. Это значит, что сражение идет у нас с вами за седьмую своего участия в гоночной команде. И опять Алексей Шин. Смотрите, блестящий гоночный опыт. Не боится он вот этом, не теряя ни скорости, ни позиции. Чуть-чуть начинает отрываться от них Глеб Кузнецов. Быстрее, немножко быстрее его автомобиль.
Обогнать более молодого пилота. А тем временем, смотрите, у нас какая напряженная борьба за вторую позицию в заезде. Владимир Шишенин и Андрей Петухов не пускают вперед Романа Огошкова. Тем временем разбираясь между собой и оттеснил уже пилоты стали.
В борьбе, что называется, пару пустяков. Да и Ефим Гантмахин совершенно не собирается сдаваться. Участвует вот в этой кутерьме, который возглавляет пока Владимир Шишенин.
Виталий Примак по-прежнему лидирует на втором месте Роман Огошков. А тут, смотрите, Глеб Кузнецов на автомобиле Volkswagen. Траектории человека, который впереди, пока нам показывают, как Юлия Струкова обгоняет в итоге одного из пилотов на автомобиле под номером 97.
Позиции и именно Гантмахер сейчас теоретически.
И вот теперь был контакт между молодым пилотом и опытным. Спихивает сначала Глеб Кузнецов.
Очень плотная, очень насыщенная и напряженная борьба. И смотри, смотри, атака Андрея Петухова. Его 10-й старт номер сейчас.
И даже занять внутренний радиус.
Нет, не успевает.
Не рискует.
Не
аккуратненько,
успевает.
Тщательно проходят пилоты. Перестраиваются в ряд на подходе ко второму повороту. Глеб Кузнецов пока расположен лучше, но все зависит от прохождения этого поворота. Мне кажется, чуть-чуть Глеба Кузнецова на выходе сносит. Там уже траектория. Есть касание с Андреем Петуховым. Такое вежливое, тщательное. Мол, на это. И пытается атаковать Василий Кораблев. Господи, запутался я уже, перечисляя этих пилотов.
Тут же пользуется Василий Кораблев. Тащит, просто все четыре колеса сносит у Андрея Петухова на его «Ладе Калине». Но теперь-то поворот для него внутренний.
Позиции – это неплохой результат. Здесь продолжается борьба, смотрите, Малинин и Голованов.
Да, по-прежнему. Сражение очень жесткое, контактное.
И сейчас появляются лидеры на прямой старт-финиш. Нет, не будет шансов у Романа Огошкова одержать вторую победу за уикенд.
The two Italian entries get through, but they don't. And second place, and Bentley lead the race now with Adelaide Form.
Yeah, brand new. They didn't even get it till last Monday.
So they dive into turn three for the first time. And crash! And that's involving one of the Bentleys and the Lamborghini, but it looks as though the Lamborghini's come off worse. The second quarter, and then by the time they got to the third, and that was the moment of impact, Lamborghini and the Bentley coming together. And to be fair, to races held.
No!
Oh, absolute disaster for the Interrush team as Richard Lyons has parked it and crashed the car here in race one of the 2016.
And
it looks as though they've come together with the Lamborghini because the doors are off.
What a
terrible sight to see this beautiful brand new Hurricane in a mess. And there is the reaction. Comes the Ferrari.
Yeah, look at that. He's got a good slipstream past the R8 Audi as well. But look at the Audi under brakes. Takes that position back. Nice move. They're capped to around 500, 600 horsepower. Look at the Audi really fighting for position now. But he's run wide.
Yeah, I mean, Sean Thong's done a very good job, and he's continuing to do so he's holding off Davide, who's a very aggressive driver.
Contact.
And these are very, very expensive cars. It's very long indeed. And the singer number 12, just going away. I thought he'd gone everything right and then blown at the last minute. That was bit.
Oh, great move there by Marchie Lee.
It's past Malaga. Here's the mistake. And I think he got unsighted by the slower Lamborghini. Come on, Andrew. Hold him off. Sauer looks
he's
up the inside at three. He's got him this time.
Yeah, he's
the checkered flag. And there it is to win race one. Kenneth Sauer wins in career in second place. A brilliant drive from the Bentley. Gets a great start, tries to sandwich himself between the two cars at the front, but Marchie Lee holds the lead. The Bentley goes to the inside.
So does
the
Ferrari.
Yes,
the Ferrari,
and
both
Marchie Lee's messed it up, and Bentley lead.
Oh, Rizzo and Lou win.
The lead goes the number 8. Great start, good clean start here in GT Asia. Good start from the Ferrari, the Singer Ferrari getting through places, and poor old Marchie Lee is going from hero to... Bentley know that this championship is going to be...
Contact.
More drama for the Lamborghini.
He's
coming
through.
Together.
He's through, though, and Marchie Lee attacks back too.
Look at this drag race.
Yeah, you're telling me that it's not even?
It's pretty even, isn't it? The Audi holds the line, though, into the right-hander, but a better turn in, though.
They head down that straight, Jonathan, but the Porsche gets in front, but the Audi dips to the inside to get the better line.
And Toy Buddy on Bacti doing a really good job.
It's not over yet, though.
It's not, is it? But look at what's hanging off the left-hand back of that Audi.
That was part of the contact from earlier on, and you can just see that. He's got to hope that that...
And make sure it was all fettled. And through goes the Bentley, and Vuitekorn makes the place.
It's not over yet.
Not quite. Good defensive driving, though.
There he goes.
And that's great driving by the Ferrari. Will not let him by. No question. And Lamborghini and Ferrari go at it at turn one. Can the 55 come alongside the 488? He does so. The Hurricane is in a hurry, and away he goes.
Of course, he hasn't had a lot of experience either in this class. Good overtaking manoeuvre there by him, though. On the number 13 of Jingzhou, of course. Jingzhou fights back, though. It's never as easy as you might think, Jonathan, this
replays. We then see how close these two have been at it throughout there. We've seen several replays now of them overtaking each other several times.
But, look at him. He's not gun-shy as Liberati. He's already having a go on Davide Rizzo there.
Yep, two Italians going at it in two very different Italian cars. The battle for third place now. Davide Rizzo and Eduardo.
And he's made the move up the inside.
Side by side up the hill.
Good move there. Nice and clean by Eduardo Liberati.
Very nicely done by Liberati. And now he's showing his could be banging into.
That was the worst time. They just started going to the
this is it, and this is what he didn't need.
No, it's good. He's moved wide. The plan that gap has come down.
Whoa, and now goes the Porsche up in smoke.
It's a rear tire.
As the big bad Bentley means business and wins in career. Roll on, Buriram, because Bentley have taken career and GT Asia by storm this week.
mañana. Ahí de costado el líder del campeonato, lo pudo sacar con los justos. ¿Quién gana esta serie? No lo sabemos. La Rauri que estira, la Rauri que le pone el auto y otra vez se tocaron. Se tocaron y claro, lo tuvo que perdonar y se le pone de costado a la Rauri. ¡Ay, la Rauri! La Rauri no lo pudo sacar.
Rossi, otra vez por afuera.
Increíble, increíble espectáculo. Rossi, 3-1. Rossi que pisó la pared, que se le pone de costado al líder. Se van afuera todos. Y Rossi Cardocci, ¿quién la gana, señoras y señores? Rossi, anda por afuera, vos le dice Rossi, la gana Rossi. Se le pone de costado, juegan a los autitos chocadores, tremendo. Caras y señores, Duogonor ganó.
Thank you. Thank you. junto a Martín Ferreira, el puntero del campeonato. Segundo asegura la frenada, doblan en la primera curva hacia la derecha. El tercero se le quiere meter, es Giovanni Elizalde. Cuarto hoy, el Fluence de Kohler. Ya.
Ahí tenemos la repetición.
De Giovanni Elizalde y de Kohler. Ahí está, el del Troya. No se le ha escapado tanto Veraza cuando se fue afuera. Otra vez Víctor Trungheliti con el prototipo Volvo.
Lo que...
de la nueva gestión provincial.
Mirá qué linda se puso la carrera, ¿eh? Se tiró con todo, está buscando la punta. Giovanni Elizalde, ahí está, cambia, se tiró. Ay, casi le mete el auto. Gran pelea entre el cruz de Martín Ferreira, el de Ceres y Giovanni Elizalde. Martín Ferreira ganó. Victoria para Ferreira en el Top Race Junior, que vuelve al cronograma de la Top Race. Pallito Sánchez, cuarto Cotiñola, quinto lugar para Nino Esganga. Oh, se pasó Regalía. ¿Pero qué hiciste, Fac? Va el ranking este, ¿eh? Se pasó de largo, agarró el agua y Regalía, que no perdió tanto de todas maneras. Y la verde va a ganar Franquito. Ganó Franco Girolami. Frario que toma la delantera. Bien Julia, va por el medio, trata de no agarrar el charco, va rumbo a la primera curva del circuito, asegura la frenada. Se escapó Julia, sobre Álvaro Perlo y Panchito, tratando de avanzar en este clasificador. Ahí está, el auto 9 de Camarota, el 71 del sanjuanino Fabricio Per. Ya comenzaron a rasparse. Top Race Series.
Muy bien, Valario, sí, por defenderle el lugar y además por una...
Fabiano e o Regis Boeste, o que tudo indica, com problemas. O André Marques vem numa crescente na categoria, o Davi Mufato. Vai acender de vez. Agora o Felipe Giafone já vai pondo de lado. A torcida reage, a torcida aplaude. Agora tem frenagem pro radar. Como é que vai ser? O Felipe quase lado a lado com o Davi Mufato. Eles vêm freando para cumprir o radar. Cadê a velocidade de radar de todo mundo? Felipe Giafone para ser o líder da prova. Reta de largada. Davi Mufato pela linha interna. Vai tratando de manter a primeira posição. Vem para cima dele. O Felipe Giafone logo atrás com o caminhão número 1. Leandro Totti, que é o segundo colocado, ataca por fora o Giafone. Bonita a pilotagem do Giafone. Pode custar caro na aproximação para a curva 2. Mas uma tocada bonita do Felipe Giafone. Na primeira curva de corrida, defendendo também o seu segundo lugar pela Leandro Mufato. O Joel Mendes Júnior. Olha o Raijão Mascarenhas. Carelo passeando pela grama, vai fazer um passeio de domingo, volta para a pista, toca o caminhão do Roberval Andrade, volta Leandro Totti para tentar o segundo lugar. Chegou a colocar o caminhão Volvo da Clay Truck Racing à frente do Felipe Giafone. Só que no olho da Band, veja só, o Beto Monteiro teve de tirar o time rapidinho. No lugar na prova, veja como vem para cima o Raijão, balançando o caminhão de um lado para outro. Vai
buscar, os caminhões vão parar.
Pronto, então é dúvida já determinada a intervenção do Pace Truck. Olha só a imagem do caminhão do Adalberto Jardim, Milton Alves. A corrida tá quente em todos os sentidos. O Fato, Marques, Cirino. Pacheco, não é por aí não, Jaidsonzini. Veio... Não tenha dúvida nenhuma, Felipe Giafone. O líder também tem problemas. Felipe Giafone foi turbina embora. A turbina do Felipe Giafone foi embora. Ultra... E olha só, tem princípio de fogo ali no caminhão do Felipe também. É um efeito até normal. Davi Mufato agora líder também vem num visual diferente, Davi Mufato. É a maldição da liderança na Fórmula Truck em Campo Grande.
E para os dois companheiros conseguir segurar aí o pessoal, o Davi parece ter um probleminha, mas é diferente do que eu tive agora. E vamos torcer, coisa de corrida.
E o André Marques também teve um probleminha. Ele vinha sendo ultrapassado. O Wellington Talney Cirino faz festa, equipe ABF Mercedes-Benz. Vem pronta a bandeira quadriculada branca e preta. Para o Wellington Cirino, mais uma dele na Fórmula Truck.
Anderson all the way back from row number 2. He will have to go to the runoff. Ed Jones, we've got Sorales off into the grass. Ed Jones remains in the lead. The guy's now going into the run. Wide, it pushed the Rutia out to the grass. A couple of the cars had to use that runoff. Sorales being one of them. He's fallen back into the 6th.
Involved in an incident on lap number 2. Standing by with Rob Houghton.
I had a really good start. Had a good gap on him, and he just... I don't know. I was already in, and he just tried to kamikaze it, and...
That's not good.
And we've got contact. Juan Pedro Heat.
That's not good.
Full course.
And it is going to be a full course, so, and that's interesting.
What happened here was Hargrove was too worried about Kaiser and his mirror. And
they're now the Homatro safety crew trying to get that three car of Scott Hargrove off of that curbing. Stefan Wilson, we're seeing another replay of it. He did. Swung awfully low to the inside to try to block Kaiser. I mean, unfortunately, that's a part of the racetrack where there's not a lot of room to pass.
Yeah, you know, it stacks up there, and I think that, as Sage rightly pointed out, Scott was just looking in his mirrors and missed his break point, and suddenly, as Scott was turning in, you know, just he had nowhere to go.
And P's and Q's. Now, Sandy Arrudio starting to look to the outside of Dean Stoneman. Stoneman dives low. Ed Jones locks him up. Stoneman to the lead. Now, Sandy Arrudio swings wide. Rosenquist still fourth, Sorales fifth, but once Dean Stoneman goes to the lead. Santiarutia all over the rear wing of Dean Stoneman.
Starts I've ever seen in motorsports, and it's not done yet. Arutia looks outside, dives to the inside at turn number 7. Santiarutia to the lead, but here comes Ed Jones. Jones sweeps around from 3rd to 1st. And he scoots away through turns 8, 9, and 10.
What an unbelievable restart as Ed Jones goes from 1st to 3rd and then back to the lead in about half of a lap. Further back, Zach Veach is looking for the 5th position. He'll slip to the inside of Felix Sorales, and now the battle for 3rd is on. Rosenquist, he'll jump to the outside of Dean Stoneman, but you can throw a blanket over about 5th through 8th or 9th. Further back, R.C. Enerson, he's looking hungry. He'll look to the inside. They'll nearly go 3 wide out of turn number 14, but then Jones will cross the yard of bricks and win at the Indianapolis Motor Speedway. Santiarutia is 2nd, Dean Stoneman 3rd, Rosenquist comes across the line in 4th, and it appears Felix Rosenquist in row 2, Dean Stoneman and R.C. Enerson in row 3, row 4 is Zach Veach and Scott Anderson. We've already got one sideways, that appears. Again, it'll be Veach starting 7th, Anderson 8th, Hargrove 9th, Shelby Blackstock 10th, Kyle Kaiser, and we're still wrecking. Green flag in the air, Ed Jones will lead the field to Michael Young in turn 1.
Well, the field looking very good. A couple stepping out. Dean Stoneman the first. Sorales battling his teammate. Ed Jones on the outside. And Sorales will miss the turn. He'll be going through the grass. It's Ed Jones, then Rosenquist. Stoneman P3. Sorales nearly pearls in front of the entire field. The field able to work their way around him. Looks to the inside. Now Ed Jones, Rosenquist, one calling separate.
Can he make it stick through 7? And from behind, Zach Veach tags his teammate Felix Rosenquist.
Then all of a sudden it's Urrutia in the 2nd place. Field at the back, you've got Kyle Kaiser getting a little bit racy. He's got to lock up the brakes. Rest of the field already now through turn 14.
And one tire, so there's about 4 or 5 cars, Michael Young, who are...
All right, walking over to R.C. Enerson right now. All right, R.C., what happened out there today?
Yeah, I mean, we just had a turbo go. We lost all boost pressure, so, I mean, it was just a huge struggle to... Maybe they gave me a great car, so I mean, it's
decide. They hit the brakes, and from behind, squeezing by from the 3rd position, Sorales side by side with Arutia.
2nd is on in turn number 1.
Sorales gets around the outside of Santi Arutia. What a great
move! An eye on that, and those three were certainly battling awful hard. That again was a battle for the 7th position.
Yeah, I mean, that's just inexperience, you know, just a move right there. Probably should have just taken the. Followed Hargrove through and tried to take 1 position instead of 2, but...
Oh, Sorales locked him up going into turn 12. He's going to go off. That's going to allow Urrutia by.
Now racing continues for Dean Stoneman. Down the front straightaway, right fist in the air, pumping as the twin checkered flags fall. Checkered flag is out, and Dean...
So much made this year about the disparity between.
As Mikhail Aloshin back into that car spun around. And again, this is what we've talked about, Mark, at a lot of other courses. Came in practice number 2 at IMS. First, Andretti Autosport rookie Alexander Rossi also looped his target Chevy around near the Speedway Museum. Laps later, sliding off course. The good news for fans of the 500 Festival Prince hopeful. Flag there, Mark, getting a chance to see the replay. James Hinchcliffe has looped that car, then a 180 there near the museum.
Trouble, cars into the outside wall. That's Sebastian Bourdais, and I believe that's Tony Kanaan. It is Kanaan, the other car. And look at.
Now, when we go and watch the start of this, guys, just watch what happens here. It looks like, honestly, I think number 9, Dixon, let's roll this now. I think what ends up happening here is he's coming along, and he's going to turn around and just start to flare off to the right-hand side, just a small amount. Tony reacts, and the blue and white car goes against towards the wall. Ends up collecting Sebastian Bourdais. So Sebastian thought that he ended up having an opportunity to maybe go around the outside. He's right along now with Tony Kanaan. Let's watch this. So he thinks he's going to go around the outside. The 9 of Scott Dixon takes his space. And so he's got to move to the left. And you know how quick this is. Remember, we haven't been in the car for a couple of hours here, Eddie. All of a sudden, here we go. Watch this, along with Sebastian Bourdais. He's got nowhere to go.
He had nowhere to go, but he could have maybe anticipated the fact that he had a wall on his left. On his left-hand side.
It's kind of like you were saying before, Eddie, right, though? You're looking to make a right-hand turn, and there the problem comes from your left for both drivers.
Right, and there's no spotter in the world that can tell you what's happening at a start like that. How very unfortunate. Those are two strong cars for this race.
Now watch how this all spreads out. Everybody's looking for a position, trying to set yourself up to the turn. Second car in line, a lot of sparks coming out of it. Yeah. And then the right behind him.
But Dixon just followed the car that was ahead of him.
Helpless.
Yeah, helpless.
We both had that feeling.
Aside, I can only imagine the frustration.
That is so frustrating when you've been practicing, you've qualified, you get through the start, you're ready to express yourself in the race, and you don't even make it to the first corner, Scott. I mean, there's few things that can drive you more crazy than that.
And especially for Sebastian, when he thinks that he's just riding along there, it's not really his fault. But you know, we see this every year coming down here. As you mentioned, Eddie, the track is so wide, and as drivers, we get greedy and look for that extra position. And then bang, what ends up happening? It's taken away from you, and you're taken out of the race. Just a chain reaction. One person moves, and it's just like something that happens on the highway. Big issue.
And breaking offline, maybe some marbles there?
Absolutely.
Don't forget, Rossi is the one that put out the bait, and he took it. He had a choice to take the bait or not to.
All right. So Will Power, you saw got going. He's back in 23rd place.
That's a terrible feeling, isn't it? We've all done it. It's just like there's no grip on the grass.
What a great shot. Look at that shot.
For the race lead.
And Pagano passed two cars.
For the second time, the Grand Prix of Indianapolis.
This is a fantastic end lap. You did that one for us. Good job.
This looks like just a slight bobble, but Phil, you know this. I mean, he is about crashed right there.
Wow.
And you could know which was smart. And now, thanks to that save, look at those hands working in there. He's going to be able to continue the fight.
Get it.
Was you see, Brandon's right behind the 22.
Oh, he gets clipped. Oh, no, he just tries to make an evasive action. You talked about those self-cleaning banks. He was actually a part of that crash when the 22 got sideways.
It looked like he was trying to avoid the 22 and just couldn't corral it in.
Just unfortunate being in the wrong place at the wrong time for Brandon Jones. Take another look at it.
He tries to look at that. Just right at the last second, he thought the 22 truck of self was going to come up the hill. He made an evasive move to the right and just spun him around on the back straightaway. This place is so tough, and that's a perfect example of the banks that you talked about, Phil, and how.
Yeah, a flat straightaway, and Brandon Jones is not involved in this accident at all. He may spin, but he can spin down the racetrack without any contact.
On board with Brandon Jones.
88, about 10 back. So watch that right in front of you there. Keep digging. You're all clear. Hold on to it, 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 hold on to it.
Ah, hard contact on the inside wall. That's just the wrong place. Yeah. He
just got loose, had to use some more racetrack, had to move up the hill. And when he did, he got into the left rear quarter panel.
Let's restart. Watch it. Double zero on the inside. He's not the lead truck. The outside truck, the 9 of William Byron's the lead truck. And they say that the double zero jumped the restart. Well, and because of that, he's been black flagged.
William Byron is
out.
The Rico 98. Abreu.
Rico Abreu in the 98. The 41 is Ben Rhodes.
Absolutely screwed up, too.
He ended up crashed, and then here's the 98 of Rico Abreu, damage on his truck as well.
Yeah, and the 41 of Ben Rhodes. Well, I wonder if they got together, because Ben was already up high into the outside wall.
I feel like they did, Phil, but we were just, we got to watch. These replays are so valuable.
FS1 cameramen and women, they just do a great job of getting us these pictures.
And a tough break for Recro Abreu. Had contact last week at Kansas, early stages of the race. Oh, watch it here from Ryan Truex's truck.
That was, looked like Ben Rhodes maybe was the truck on the inside. Got loose and got into Recro.
And you remember
from that caution clock coming out.
Look at our leader, Crafton. This should be Townley just ahead of him. Yeah.
Ooh.
And then it just snaps back the wrong direction.
Hard hit for Townley.
What a break for Timothy Peters. That's him right in front of John West Townley. So he more than likely will remain on the lead lap by virtue of this caution flag. Look at that safer barrier there. Thank you so much for them.
Yeah, no kidding. You and I have both challenged these monsters' walls when that safer barrier wasn't there.
Yeah, that beat us most of the time.
Hang on to it here with William Byron pressuring him.
And see, Byron, his truck was pushing because the air off of the 29.
He's bringing it home for his first ever win at Dover.
Baby, we finally won here. Oh, my God. I never thought it happened. You guys are the best, man. We got the best team, the best sponsors, the best owners, the best of everything. You guys are awesome.
There he is, Junior Joyner, the crew chief that masterminds.
Rex here from Cup practice. I'm going to tell you, this is going through everyone's mind right now.
The 43 car, you can see right there, just up out of the groove, and it snaps around.
He was definitely above that black area, which you get up in there, it's almost probably like being on ice almost.
He had run the 14th fastest time in this session. That was a lap before last, so he was just trying to pick up some more speed.
They have finished in the top eight in the first nine races of the year. And here's that tight racing we saw a moment ago.
See, it leaves a little mark there on the 88 right behind the left front tire. And what happens there, guys, is the
black flag.
So he's definitely going to get a push here from the three car, but he also rolls a little bit early here on the 19. Gosh, you know, it's hard to say on this one, guys.
But he definitely beat him to the start-finish line. And they tell you in the driver's meeting, you cannot beat the control car to the start-finish line. It's black and white.
It looks like Elliott checked up a little. Like he got a little high on the racetrack and it snapped on him here, Michael.
Oh, sideways. Watch it hit that inside wall so hard.
Looked a little bit like Jeb Burton yesterday in practice.
Thank goodness we have safer barriers down there. You just can't appreciate how hard a hit that is.
And there's no safer barrier there after he tangles with that outside wall. That's hard.
He hit the inside wall a lot faster and at worse of an angle. And you can see the car wasn't as tore up into it.
Ty Dillon, Daniel Suarez 1-2, and it. There they are, up left front. These are teammates here.
Oh, he gets loose, and I bet he slides up into, yes, and put Brandon Jones into the outside wall, and that rubs.
Oh,
we got a problem with the two.
He's smoking.
Stay out this late in the going, but look, just loose is Brendan gone. That tells you how much these guys are fighting these cars once the tires get some laps on them. Now you're going to have to stock them up and restart them on those older tires.
Well, crew chief, it's all on your shoulders.
Yeah, it's days like this. I'm glad I'm in the Hollywood Hotel.
Team for Eric Jones comes and Dover.
Definitely oil coming out from under the car. See if we can get back up here and see where it starts.
Here she comes Danica.
Off turn four. You see it starts smoking. Ooh.
And look at the one car gets into the oil, and then he hits the wall extremely hard.
Yep.
Then Tony's in the oil as well, and he goes spinning into the inside wall. That was a big impact by the one car.
And he's just trying to get Jamie Murray's trying to get his car woed up so he doesn't get into Tony down here on the inside of the track.
And a long slide down to the wall for Tony. Something blew up in a big way right there.
Ginger.
Well, the good news, Tony, he's climbing out under his own power.
Yeah. About Tony, and you know, the only thing that he's fearful of is making contact with a wall like this, you don't really know how strong his back truly is until he goes through something like this. But we don't want to, and I know he doesn't want to see himself go into an incident.
He said on the radio, he said it hurt. Now, he did hit the wall coming off four.
About halfway down here, you saw him get into the oil.
And then again, no, that was the second hit, Daryl. He hit it just at the exit of four. One of those. What? Jamie slides down the front stretch. Now, there's Danica bouncing off the wall. There's. What happened to Matt DiBenedetto?
Oh, he's getting wide. Did he blow right front tire?
Yeah, it never turns, Jeff. That thing straight up the hill into the wall. That's definitely looks like a right front tire.
Luckily, he caught the safer barrier there. Yep. And then at that point, everything's damaged so badly. Guessing it's going to bring him down to the inside safer barrier.
Not sure who that was right behind him, but what a nice save.
Yeah, something definitely broke or failed on that car. There's no doubt about that.
Bam.
Yeah, just
raised it. Look, it raised the right front of Tony's car almost off the ground. He hit so hard.
Yeah, I think Tony. Hey.
We heard on the radio that he said something broke on the car. He's coming off turn four here, or just about ready to, and the car did just spin around with him. Not sure what the problem might be.
Something may have broke, but it definitely broke traction getting in there.
That's for sure. It could have been a rear end problem.
Jamie.
Kurt Busch pits from fourth place. Right sides is the call.
And the AAA Chevy.
You could just hear it laying down on the splitter.
I heard you saw rubber flying up off the thing.
I don't know if the right front tire went down or some component in the suspension broke there, but you could hear it down on the splitter before he ever got to the corner. There's no chance it was ever going to turn.
It spins, probably gets in the oil right here, and then the four just had to come to a complete stop. The 48 back here spins. Here's Harvick right behind him. 48. Goes down and the four just stops to keep from hitting it.
Yeah, you could see the 48 was right in the tracks of that oil that came off of Reed Sorensen's car, and it just broke loose on him. The four, he just stood on the brakes to stay out of it.
Now, Jim, let's ride with Harvick.
Watch that 48 car up here.
Stay low, low, low. He's spinning. He's up high, but he's going to come down, Kevin. Just watch him up there. Easy now. Easy.
Whoa.
The apron. Outside. Easy. Outside.
Unfortunately, because he came to that stop, I don't know if he stalled it, but he definitely lost a lot of positions because he stopped, even though he didn't have any damage.
He's coming down, backing down. He's going to come down the track. He's going to come down the track. Stay low. Stay low. Stay low. Stay low. I'll go follow him. Watch out. One out. Clear high. Clear.
Stay low. Stay low. Okay, go high. That's going to be a good shot.
Well, Carl Edwards caught a little bit of that oil as well. You saw him wiggling, trying to stay out of it. 24 car is the one that really made some gains there.
But the 48 did get a little front end damage. I don't know if it hurt the nose or not, but he did make contact with that whatever that black car was.
46, Michael Annette.
Coming off turn four here.
Yeah, ooh, slight like contact.
Looked like McMurray might have got up the hill just enough to get in the side of the 46 car, and that sent him sailing. Bam, bam.
That is right about where Danica Patrick ended up in the wall after that crash very early in Friday practice.
Yeah, Mike, your car is really loose and light right there coming up out of the corner, and all it takes is just a little touch, and it'll send you sailing, send you around.
It looked like McMurray was so focused on trying to get ahead of the 44 of Brian Scott and maybe thought he was going to tuck in right behind the 46, just misjudged it, got into his...
And here comes Brad, and he just couldn't get out from behind him, and he clips him right there pretty good.
Ooh.
I mean, that's just how much momentum and how hard it is to react. You can see it smoking. That's usually the rear end housing has moved around
and sliding around,
gone to the left and is rubbing the fender well, but doesn't.
I'm not sure about
it. Doesn't
that.
Exactly make sense why the 34 spun out.
Not sure about that one.
Is it
possible? No, Johnson's out of it. He can't go.
Big wreck going to happen here on the front straight.
Oh, no, man. You are kidding me.
Look at who came out front, though, on the back straightaway, Matt Kenseth. And something broke, or he didn't get it into third gear.
It just, yeah, he never took off.
Well, yeah, he couldn't go, and everybody behind him couldn't stop.
No.
Let's have a look first from the Goodyear blimp. The red flag is out at Dover. The front straightaway pretty well blocked. So here's the restart.
It's a nice jump here.
Yeah, he starts to go, but it looks like when he shifts.
That's where he shifted third.
Third, and it just didn't, something happened.
And then here comes trouble.
It's on from there.
Look who this takes out, the 78, the 4, 47. All these cars piling in there, nowhere to go. Ricky Stenhouse Jr.
Bam, right into the 24.
Kyle Busch.
Going to be easier to tell you who's not involved.
Goodness gracious.
The 2, the 11.
Let's ride with Kevin Harvick.
Green flag, green flag. All rolling. Second out, check it. Go low. Hold your line.
And then he gets pile driven from behind.
He almost got through it. You could hear him kind of throttling through it, and then somebody got into the back of him.
All right, let's ride with Ricky Stenhouse.
Did the one break.
Next, Dale Earnhardt Jr.
From the mark. Steady. Good. Yeah, I think it's rolling really good.
That was a big impact right there. You could hear it.
Keep
and
rolling
see
there if
it.
You can, buddy.
Man, that was hard.
Very hard impact.
Holy smokes. It just looks like when he went to third gear, Jeff, that it either broke the gear or they never went. I don't know what
just
happened.
Just wouldn't come out of second. Wouldn't, it was stuck in second.
Shift.
I don't know what would cause it to do that.
And then back where Allmendinger and Newman were, everybody was coming full throttle.
Oh, yeah, you're winding it up in third gear. You're getting up. You got a lot of speed at that point.
From pit road, from the handheld cameras. Well, Martin Truex electing to restart on the outside was just a bad draw.
Yeah, I don't think, didn't mind that.
Kenseth got a good jump.
Look at Kurt Busch battling out there on the outside of the 19. Whoa, wrecked down the back straight of the 19.
You kidding me?
Big wreck behind you, caution south.
Well, we knew that it was today.
There's Larson on the right coming up behind Edwards.
Yeah, he got
right
a little
here.
Loose.
Yeah, you know what? I think you're right. I think Carl got a little loose.
He was under the 41. That sucked him around just a tiny bit. The back end stepped out ever so slightly, and he had to check up, and the 42 just had momentum.
Yeah, he's sideways, and Larson's on the gas.
Now, wait a minute.
I mean, I understand Carl saying, hey, cut me a break. You know, he's saying, yeah, I got a little loose, and I need you to maybe check up a little bit. But and he blocked him a little bit, too. He definitely ran a low line there.
Yeah.
Pow.
That is a look at that safer bear. Look at. Oh, my gosh.
That's
how the car looks.
Vicious hit.
Back.
Mean.
I imagine that no matter how good a shape you're in, that would hurt.
It picks you up off the ground. You've had a hard hit. I don't know. I think I might, you know, I thought Larson maybe had gotten into Carl and caused this, but I'm not so sure. It didn't start, and Larson was just a part of it.
So much for our front bumper camera.
Back 42, turn it back here.
Kind of hear those tires break loose on the Carl's car.
You know what else I saw there? The 41 about got in the wall and checked up, and I think possibly allowed the 42 to get by him.
And let's hear what Kyle Larson had to say.
Touch him or did you just lose it?
I touched the 19. I don't know if what happened outside of me. I don't know if they must have got into each other or down in my right front. I mean, I feel bad if that was my fault, but I don't think it was.
One outside. Check up.
Oh, that was close.
Great driving right there.
You're all good, right?
comes Kenseth.
Boy, that 42 is going to get into the back of that 24 yet.
He's going to try to use Logano as a pick.
A lot of that was Logano didn't move out of the way. He stayed out in the groove there and held Matt up a little bit.
Oh, look at this. Ah! He's going to move him.
And did.
Oh, don't lose it.
It ain't over yet, boys.
Oh, my God, what a battle.
What drive off Kenseth has. Oh, up high, and Larson's got room underneath.
He can get underneath him there. He just can't clear him off of four.
Two to go.
He's going to try him. He's trying on the outside. There. He's looking, but he can't quite get there.
Man.
Come on. Come on, white flag.
And now Elliott is right back with them.
Boy, Matt went way up high that turn.
White flag in the air. Coming to one to go. Sponsored by Credit One Bank. And they're each two car lengths apart.
Something special is going to happen here off of turn two and through three and four.
I think Matt Kenseth's got him enough breathing room. I don't think he can get there now. And Matt's doing a way
lap car
job.
Out of the way.
Don't
Larson on the
Larson.
Bottom. Here he comes. Kenseth rides the high groove all the way to the checkered flag. Matt Kenseth wins
awesome
at Dover.
Race. Awesome race.
When that groove.
Oh, he just grabbed another gear.
He pulled down right in front of his pit stall so his crew could join in the celebration. Kyle Larson, Chase Elliott, what a race.
It was.